Hello everyone, welcome to the fifth chapter of our course on sampling. This is the first of two chapters where we're going to focus on the proper ways in which to collect data. In this chapter, we're going to be looking mostly at taking samples from some larger population. This chapter on sampling will be broken into two parts. In part one, we're going to learn to make the distinction between populations and the samples that we take from them. We're going to stress the advantages of using chance in your sampling procedures. And then we're going to look at three of the many different ways to use chance in sampling. The most common and simplest is simple random sampling. But we'll also look at some other procedures. We'll look at stratified sampling and cluster sampling. Always remember to make sure that the necessary packages are loaded. So, population versus sample. Let's make some definitions. The population is going to be the set of all items of interest. So these could be people, or these could be other things. The sample is the subset of that population for which we actually have data. Another definition. A parameter is a number that you could compute if you knew the entire population. For example, suppose the population is all adults. Then some examples of parameters that are associated with that population might be the mean height of all these adults. And this is symbolized by the Greek letter mu. We also might look at the standard deviation of the heights of the adults, and this is symbolized by the Greek letter sigma. And finally, we might consider the proportion of all of these adults who have some characteristics, such as that they play tennis. And proportions tend to be symbolized by a letter P in the English language. So these are just three of many possible numbers that could be associated with the population. These are three parameters that we'll often be interested in the future. Sometimes you might wonder how the course gets its name. It gets its name from the concept that we're about to define. A statistic is a number that you can compute from your sample data. So suppose that we have a sample from the population of all adults. Examples of statistics, things that we could compute from the sample, might be the sample mean of the heights, which we denote x with a bar on top, and we call it x bar sometimes. Or the sample standard deviation s of the heights. Or we might choose to count up the number of people in the sample who play tennis and divide by the sample size, getting a proportion of people in the sample who play tennis. That proportion is called the sample proportion, also symbolized by the P with a little hat on top. The hat in statistics tends to mean estimation of some sort. Now, the thing to keep in mind is that parameters are fixed because they're associated with the population, which we regard as fixed, at least at a particular time. However, we don't usually know the parameters because usually the population is very large and we have no way to have access to all the members of the population. The statistics, on the other hand, are not fixed. The statistics are numbers you compute from the sample, so they depend on the sample that you've chosen. On the other hand, at least you can know the statistics, whereas you cannot know the parameters. So what you try to do is come up with ways to use statistics to estimate parameters. For example, we might hope that the sample mean x bar is a fairly good approximation to the population mean mu, or that the sample standard deviation is a good approximation to the population standard deviation, or that the sample proportion is somewhere close to the population proportion that we're interested in. Small caveat here. Keep in mind that for the approximations to tend to be good, the sample should be representative of the population. That is, it should look more or less like a miniature cross-section of the population. So what we want to do is to find and use methods of sampling for which the sample is likely to be representative of the population. So How do we get a representative sample? What kinds of methods are likely to give us representative samples from the population? Should we perhaps just let potential subjects in the population choose whether or not to be in the sample? If we do, then we're doing what's called volunteer sampling. So here's an example. Suppose you'd like to conduct an opinion survey on quality of food in the school cafeteria, and your procedure is to leave forms at the entrance for people to fill out. Let's think about the ways in which this sample might have some problems. Generally, volunteers differ from the general population in some important way. In our example, the students who take the time to fill out that survey form might have stronger opinions one way or another, for the food or against the food, than those who don't bother to fill out the form at all. And so the folks in your sample are actually likely to be different from the folks in the general population in terms of the strengths of their opinions. Well, if potential subjects shouldn't decide whether or not they get into the sample, maybe the researchers should decide who gets into the sample. Here's an example of this, back from the 1948 U.S. presidential elections. At that time, major polling agencies tended to use a method called quota sampling to gather a sample of voters to poll as to which presidential candidate they favored. Now, quota sampling worked like this. You hired interviewers, these are the actual pollsters, who would contact people face-to-face. They would actually interview folks in person and ask them their opinions about who ought to be president. Now, each interviewer was given a set of assignments called a quota. For example, you might be told, go and find 10 women and 10 men. And of these five women, maybe three of them should be of a certain race, and the other seven should be of some other race. And of the 10 men, and again, some characteristics are listed. And by carefully dividing up characteristics among the many interviewers who were hired to do the work, the hope was to obtain in the end a sample that looked like the population with respect to many characteristics that might be related to how a person is going to vote. So that's quota sampling. Now, it's important to stress that within the requirement that you find a certain number of people with a certain characteristic, after that, it's entirely up to you as the interviewer which people who satisfy these characteristics you actually want to approach in order to poll them. So this led to some problems. When the researchers, the hired interviewers in this case, used their own judgment to decide on the sample, they actually unintentionally chose unrepresentative samples. In the 1948 quota sampling, a lot of the pollsters ended up interviewing folks that they felt they would like to approach, folks who perhaps did not look as threatening or looked more likable in some way to them. Well, these folks turned out to be wealthier than the average person. And wealthy folks tended to vote Republican in 1948, so the folks who got into the poll tended to be more Republican than on average. So the Republican candidate led the Democratic candidate in 1948 through all of the polls quite substantially, and yet the Democratic candidate won the actual election. This caused a revolution in the way that we do sampling for presidential polling and other types of political polling. Folks moved away from quota sampling when they realized how it was likely to produce unrepresentative samples. But this raises a little bit of a conundrum. If you can't let subjects decide whether to be in the sample, and you can't let researchers decide who should be in the sample, then what should decide who gets into the sample? The answer is somewhat surprising. Just let chance decide who gets into the sample. That is, we should use some form of random sampling. We need to use chance, but in a controlled and quantifiable way. And by that I mean roughly, we should use it in a way so that ideally, for each person in the population, we could know or compute the probability for that person to be in the sample. So now we're going to look at several different methods of random sampling. The first, and the most basic, is simple random sampling. Suppose that you're planning to take a sample of size, let's say n, from a population. If you take the sample in such a way that every set of n subjects in that population has the same chance to be the sample selected, then that's simple random sampling. Here's a useful model for thinking what it's like. It's as if you had a box full of tickets, one for every member of the population. And then you reached into the box and you just sort of randomly swished around all of the tickets and then blindly picked out one of them so that every ticket had the same chance to be picked. Then you read the ticket, found out which person it corresponded to, and then set that ticket aside, not putting it back in the box, but instead putting it aside. Then you randomly pick out another ticket, read it, and set it aside, and you keep on doing that until you've drawn n tickets out of the box. So I stress, this is drawing your n tickets at random from the box, without replacement. After all, you don't want to give yourself the chance to draw the same person twice, because once you have information on that person, it's a waste to get information from them again. So simple random sampling turns out to be equivalent to this procedure of drawing your n items at random from a box without replacement. Simple random sampling works amazingly well, especially when the sample size gets to be large. As a way of indicating how well it works, we should take a look at a manipulate app that we have. So in the app, you're looking at our imaginary population, ImagePop, from the TigerStats data frame. And you can focus on one variable at a time, indicated in the little checkbox here. And you can also choose a sample size, and we'll keep our sample size for the moment somewhere around 1,000 people. By clicking the button, you can actually take a sample. Since sex is a factor variable, then you could get the distribution of sex by looking at bar charts. The bar chart you see over in the graph gives you the distribution of sex for the population in red. And you can see that the two red bars are both at about 0.5, so there's about 50% male and female in the population. Now, to take a random sample, we simply click the button. And you can see that the blue bars moved a little bit. That's because they represent the percentages of males and females in the sample. Notice they don't quite agree with the percentages for the population, but they're mighty close. If we keep on clicking, we'll be getting samples of around size 1,000. And you can see that although the sample proportions vary from sample to sample, they stay pretty close to the population proportions of males and females. As far as sex is concerned, simple random sampling seems to be doing a pretty good job at size 1,000. You can look at some other variables too. Let's look at a numerical one like income. So what you see for graph here is a density curve that gives you the distribution of income for the population. You also see a histogram in blue. This is a histogram of a sample of the given size, which is about 1,000 here. And we can see that the sample incomes do tend to look representative of the population incomes. Simple random sampling appears to have done a good job. It's also a good idea to look over into the console, where you get some statistics both on the sample and on the population. So, for example, in the population, the mean income was about $40,316. In this particular sample, the mean income, the X bar, the sample mean, was about $40,630. So it wasn't very far off. If we keep on taking samples, we'll see that although the population parameters, such as the mean and the median and the quartiles and so on, although they stay the same from one sample to another, the sample statistics, the mean, the median, the quartiles, and so on, change from sample to sample. However, at a large sample size like 1,000, these simple random samples tend to resemble the population a great deal, and so the sample statistics tend to be close to the population means. Not always equally close. And if you go on long enough, you might be able to find some situations where, say, a sample mean is pretty far from a population mean. Just because it's simple random sampling doesn't mean that you can't get an unlucky sample from time to time. And in fact, statistical theory says if you go on long enough, you've got to get unlucky samples eventually, or at least that you're highly likely to. Let's now take a look at stratified sampling. We saw with our app that simple random sampling seemed to be doing a mighty good job of producing representative samples, most or all of the time, if the sample size was fairly large. But what if the sample size was small? For example, let's think about the distribution of sex in a MajPop. We can get an exact numeric look at it by taking row percents of the cross table for sex in a MajPop. So the population proportion of females, P, let us say, is exactly 49.68%. But now let's imagine taking a simple random sample of size 10 from this population. And if we want to do it quickly without an app, there's a function for it that's written into TigerStats called PopSamp. It takes a sample, a simple random sample, from a population that you put in as your first argument. And the second argument is the size of the sample. Let's try it a few times. What we'll do is take the sample, we'll put it into an object called MySample, and then we'll take row percents of sex in MySample. So every time we repeat these two lines of code, we'll get a different MySample, and we'll get a different set of row percentages. But it'll show us how simple random sampling is representing the population with respect to sex at these small sample sizes. So in my first attempt, only 10% of the sample was female and 90% were male. One out of my 10 were female. That's pretty far off. Trying again. Did better that time, 60% female in the sample, when the actual population proportion is that 49.68%, pretty close to 50%. Continuing to do it a few times, and I encourage you to try it yourself to see, you'll notice that many times you'll be very close, your sample proportion will be very close to the population proportion, but there are those occasional instances when your sample proportion is very, very far from the population proportion that you're trying to estimate. A sample can be unlucky, and the chance of it being unlucky in a serious way is higher at small sample sizes, where chance variability in percentages is higher. So if we're not always going to be pleased with the results of simple random sampling, And the likelihood of being displeased is somewhat high at these small sample sizes. What should we do? Well, stratified sampling offers a way to get the sample right, at least with respect to one or two or a few variables. The idea is to break the population into homogeneous groups that are called strata. So homogeneous groups are groups that are the same in the sense that all the members of the group are very similar. The different strata will be different from each other, but the people within each stratum will be similar to each other. Once we've created the strata, then we'll use simple random sampling to sample a set number of people from each stratum. So here's an example. Let's take a small imaginary population called fake school, which is available as a data frame in the TigerStats package. Let's say you only have time to sample 7 out of these 28 students. You plan to ask them questions about academic life, so you want the sample to exactly resemble the population with respect to the variable honors that's in the data frame. Honors, which has values yes and no, indicate whether the student was an honor student or not. Since your honor status probably has something to do or is related in some way to the answers you're liable to give to questions about academic life, it seems to be a good idea to try to get your little sample to be as close to right as possible, at least with respect to honors. So you construct two strata because there are two values for the variable honors. Your first stratum will be all of the honors students. You can actually isolate this as a sub-data frame of the original data frame using the subset function. So if you take a subset of fake school, all of the folks who said, yes, I'm in the honors program, then you have a new data frame that I'm going to call honors. And you could take a look at it. Next, you construct a stratum consisting of all the non-honor students in the population. So these are all of the students at fake school where the value for honors is equal to no. And we call this data frame non-honors. Again, if you wanted to look, you could just print it out using non-honors on its own line. In the population, it turns out that there were 12 honor students and 16 non-honor students. You're planning to take a sample of size 7, so you actually want to get 3 honor students into that sample and 4 non-honor students into that sample. Why is that? Because that would make the sample exactly proportional to the population as far as honor status is concerned. 3 divided by 12 is 4 over 16. The honor students in the sample divided by the honor students in the population is equal to the non-honor students in the sample divided by the non-honor students in the population. So you need to sample 3 honor students by simple random sampling. Imagining that you're planning to do a formal study of this, you want your work to be reproducible and for everyone to see how you got that sample. So you should set a seed now that you're going to actually record the results of your random sampling process. Pick a familiar number, set the seed to it, and then take a sample from the population of honors students of size 3, and maybe you get this sample, these 3 honor students. Then again, setting a seed so that everyone can see what you're doing, take a sample from the 16 non-honor students. It needs to be a sample of size 4. And here they are. If you combine these two samples, you've got your stratified sample. And because of the proportionality, it's guaranteed to be just like the population with respect to whether or not the person is an honor student. Because of the small sample size, it could differ from the population in some other ways that are relevant to how you might answer questions about academic life. Stratified sampling is not a guaranteed, surefire procedure for dealing with small sample sizes to make everything perfect. But at least with respect to some important variables, maybe you can make your sample more likely to be accurate by using stratified sampling. Stratified sampling actually is more accurate than simple random samples. And this advantage is most evident at these small sample sizes. But there's a big disadvantage to stratified sampling. In order to use it, you have to know how the variable that you're stratifying by is distributed in the population before you even take your sample. So, in the example, we had to know the number of honors and number of on-honor students in the population in order to figure out how many non-honors and honor students we wanted in the sample. A third method of random sampling that's quite popular is cluster sampling. Cluster sampling deals with the following possible problem with simple random sampling. In order to actually take a simple random sample, you would have to be able to identify every subject in the population before you take that sample. By identify, I mean having a way of knowing that they're there and being able to reach them. So in the tickets from a box model, in order to take a simple random sample, you have to have the tickets to put into your box. You don't know what those tickets contain on them. You haven't interviewed the subject yet. But you have to know those subjects are there and how to reach them, how to put your hands on them, as it were. This can be difficult with large and uncontrolled populations. Imagine wildlife populations, for example. Even human populations are very, very difficult to take a census of. There's another problem with simple random sampling, and it has to do with what might happen if you need to contact each sampled person face-to-face, if you need to actually travel in order to interview the person. If you're on the server, then you could find and run the following function called SquareSamp, and then you could take a look at it. We'll just show it here. So the idea behind the SquareSamp function is that it's going to take a simple random sample of 10 dots out of a rectangular array of very many dots, I believe 2,500 of them actually. Every time you try the function, you'll get a different sample. Now watch how these 10 dots are spread out within the available rectangle. Imagine that if you had to go around and find each one of these dots, let's say you were a dot on that square somewhere that's just about as big as these other dots, you'd have to go around in a rather complex and a rather expensive way in order to reach everyone. And that's because most of the time folks are fairly scattered out from each other. So cluster sampling offers a way to get around these two problems. The idea of cluster sampling is to try to divide the population into disjoint subsets, which are called clusters, each cluster being as representative of the population as you can make it. Whereas members of a strata are very similar to each other, members of the same cluster will probably be different from each other, about as different as people in the population are from each other. Once you've got your clusters, then you sample a few of the clusters by simple random sampling. And then you can contact each of the subjects in each one of the selected clusters. This is cluster sampling. You can see the convenience of this. Since the sample comes in a set of clusters and everyone in a cluster is fairly close to each other, then it might be easier to reach them all. So for example, cluster sampling might use the idea of breaking the United States down into states and picking a few states at random and then trying to interview folks within the state. There's less traveling that way. So it can sometimes be easier to get to your selected subjects. Another advantage is that you don't have to identify all of the subjects in the clusters in advance. You do have to be able to identify all of the clusters in advance. Once you've selected the cluster, then you want to find a way to reach the people in the cluster. But since a cluster tends to be small and the population is large, it may be easier to deal with that problem in a cluster. One disadvantage, though, is that clusters seldom approach that ideal of being exact representations of the population. And so the results you get from your cluster sample can depend very heavily on which clusters were selected at random. Cluster sampling can therefore be quite a bit more variable than such things as simple random sampling or stratified sampling. Thank you for listening.